no sense.
Here I come.
It's time for another edition of our weekly top five. This week, we grab us a booth, some coffee, and a shit ton of bacon as we take an appetizing look at our favorite diner scenes from the Tarantino verse.
Veuillez m'excuser, j'ai oublié de commander la crème. Un instant. Attendez la crème.
No director is more obsessed with food as a storytelling device than Tarantino. In every single one of his 12 films, there's at least one scene centered around a culinary-infused conversation. In fact, some of his greatest dialogue scenes are delivered whilst eating or sitting around a dining table, and the majority of these scenes take place inside the homey confines of American diners. There's at least one diner scene in 7 of his first 8 movies, and these are our 5 favorites. Number 5, the key lime pie with a side of ass-kicking in Natural Born Killers. In Tarantino's earlier films, grabbing a slice of pie was a key contributor for his characters to pop into a local diner and strike up a conversation. In the case of the Knoxes, they were just making a pit stop on their cross-country murder spree so that Mickey could give Key Lime Pie another try.
Which do you recommend?
Well, lime's great, but it's an acquired taste.
Well, I ain't had Key Lime Pie in 10 years.
When you had it, did you like it?
No, but that don't mean much. I was a completely different person back then. Let's give that key lime pie a day in court.
And Mallory could lose herself in the establishment's jukebox selection. But when some local rednecks drop in looking for trouble, they bite off way more than they can chew.
Bill, Bill, don't stop now, darling. I'm just getting started.
Hey, I think she's sweet on you.
Are you flirting with me?
Maybe.
You want a piece of the gun? Do you?
Your move, fucker, go!
Number 4, the Everybody Be Cool coffee shop robbery in Pulp Fiction. The first two films that Tarantino directed open with blue-collar criminal types mesmerizing us with their titillating conversations and witty banter. Few movie openings are greater than Pulp Fiction's, where two thick-as thieves lovebirds, Honey Bunny and Pumpkin, have a philosophical debate over coffee about their line of work.
I mean, the way it is now, taking the same risk as when you rob a bank. Taking more of a risk. Banks are easier. Federal banks ain't supposed to stop you in any way during a robbery. You're insured. Why should they give a fuck? Don't even need a gun in a federal bank. Heard about this one bloke, he walks into a bank with a portable phone. He gives the phone to the teller. The bloke on the other end of the phone says, "We got this guy's little girl. If you don't give him all your money, we're gonna kill her."
Did it work?
Fucking right, it works. That's what I'm talking about. Knucklehead walks into a bank with a telephone. Not a pistol, not a shotgun, but a fucking phone. Cleans the place out, they don't even lift a fucking finger.
This in turn leads to an impromptu armed robbery of said coffee shop, which pays off in the film's climax. Only those with keen senses will hear Jules and Vincent's conversation in the background or see Vincent making his way to the bathroom.
See, I got the idea. The last liquor store we stuck up, remember?
Mm-hmm.
All the customers kept coming in.
Yeah.
You got the idea, taking their wallets.
Mm-hmm.
Now that was a good idea.
Thank you.
Made more from the wallets than we did from the register.
Yes, we did.
A lot of people come to restaurants.
A lot of wallets.
Pretty smart, huh?
I'm ready. Let's do it right now, right here. Come on.
Right. Same as last time, remember? Your crowd control. I handle employees.
Mm-hmm. I love you, Pumpkin.
I love you, Honey Bunny.
Everybody be cool, this is a robbery!
Any of you fucking pricks move! And I'll execute every motherfucking last one of you!
Number 3, the theological debate with a side of bacon in Pulp Fiction. Tarantino masterfully bookends Pulp Fiction with diner scenes that take place in the same diner at the same time. Because this film is a nonlinear anthology story with each story intersecting in ways we don't see coming, we as the audience have completely forgotten about the opening scene, highlighted in our number four, until it rears its head at the conclusion of Jules and Vincent's conversation.
What's in the case?
My boss's dirty laundry.
Your boss makes you do his laundry?
When he wants it clean.
Sounds like a shit job.
Funny, I was thinking the same thing.
Open it.
Afraid I can't do that.
I didn't hear you?
Yes, you did.
A conversation that begins with a debate over pork as a suitable culinary choice.
Want some bacon?
No, man, I don't eat pork.
Are you Jewish?
No, I ain't Jewish. I just don't dig on swine, that's all.
Why not?
Pigs are filthy animals. I don't eat filthy animals.
Yeah, but bacon tastes good. Pork chops taste good.
Hey, sewer rat may taste like pumpkin pie, but I'd never know because I wouldn't eat the filthy motherfuckers.
And concludes with a theological debate about surviving the events from the apartment earlier that morning. The result is a scene as delicious as Vincent's bacon.
You guys are starting to lighten up. You've been sitting there all serious and shit.
Oh, man, I've just been sitting here thinking.
About what?
About the miracle we witnessed.
Miracle you witnessed. I witnessed a freak occurrence.
What is a miracle, Vincent?
Act of God.
And what's an act of God?
When God makes the impossible possible. But this morning, I don't think qualifies.
Hey, Vincent, don't you see that shit don't matter? You're judging this shit the wrong way. I mean, it could be God stopped the bullets, or he changed Coke to Pepsi, he found my fucking car keys. You don't judge shit like this based on merit. Now, whether or not what we experienced was an according to Hoyle miracle is insignificant. But what is significant is I felt the touch of God. God got involved.
But why?
Well, that's what's fucking with me. I don't know why, but I can't go back to sleep.
You serious? You really thinking about quitting?
The life?
Yeah.
Most definitely.
Fuck. What's you gonna do then?
Well, that's what I've been sitting here contemplating. First, I'm gonna deliver this case to Marcellus. Then, basically, I'm just gonna walk the earth.
What you mean, walk the earth?
You know, like Kane in Kung Fu. Walk from place to place, meet people, get in adventures.
And how long do you intend to walk the earth?
Till God puts me where he wants me to be.
And what if you don't do that?
If it takes forever, then I'll walk forever.
Number two, the single lawn take reunion breakfast in Death Proof. It's a cinematic achievement in a director's career to not only pull off a seamless one-take scene, but to do it in such a way that it's so engrossing that the fact it's all in one take completely slips past the audience. Tarantino masterfully does this with the snappy banter between the second set of female victims in the second half of this film. It's over 7 minutes in length and covers three separate but rapid-fire conversations, starting with the clumsiness of Zoe Bell. See if you can spot stuntman Mike lurking in the background.
It's dark as hell and you can't see shit. So she's got her camera and keeps saying, step back a little. So I do. Then a little further. So I step back a little further. Then a little more. So I do. Then I realize I'm right at the edge of a 7-foot concrete ditch with God knows how many rocks and broken bottles and rats in it. And if I fell in that fucking thing, I probably would have broken my fucking neck. So I'm yelling at her, Zoe, you almost killed me. So we laugh about it and walk a little further. And Zoe starts fucking around. And damn, if she doesn't fall in the fucking ditch. Oh.
Nice. Thank you.
Yep, thank you. I remember taking a step and looking down. Just as I'm thinking, oh, there's that ditch Abby was talking about. Bam, I'm in the fucking ditch.
Then the need for Kim to carry a gun.
Look. I don't know what futuristic utopia you live in, but the world I live in, a bitch need a gun.
You can't get around the fact that people who carry guns tend to get shot more than people who don't.
And you can't get around the fact that if I go down to the laundry room in my building at midnight enough times, I might get my ass raped.
Don't do your laundry at midnight.
Fuck that. I want to do my laundry whenever the fuck I want to do my laundry.
There are other things you can carry other than a gun. Pepper spray.
Motherfucker try to rape me? I don't want to give him a skin rash. I want to shut that nigga down.
And finally, what Zoe's plans are during her first trip to America.
I've been getting the paper for the last month, mm-hmm. And I've been checking the classified at the back looking at cars for sale. So,
as of yesterday, for sale in this town. Some dude is selling a stock 1970 Dodge Challenger with a 440 engine and a white paint job.
And you want to buy it?
Kim, I may be stupid, but I'm not bloody stupid. I want to say I want to buy it, so he'll let me test drive it. A 1970 Dodge Challenger with a white paint job.
Oh, Kowalski.
Kowalski from Vanishing Point. Mate, it's a fucking classic. If I can get this guy to let me drive it without him, I will blow the doors off that bitch.
And our number one is the original Tarantino vs. Diner scene from Reservoir Dogs. This scene put Hollywood on notice that not only was Tarantino going to be a director to be reckoned with, but that he was also a brilliant fucking writer way ahead of his time. There are 8 actors in this scene, all with dialogue, that not only give us insight into who they are as characters, but there is heavy foreshadowing of events to come. The scene starts out with Mr. Brown's crude interpretation of what Madonna's Like a Virgin is actually about.
Let me tell you what Like a Virgin's about. It's all about this coos, who's a regular fuck machine. Now I'm talking morning, day, night, afternoon. Dick, 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 dick.
How many dicks is that?
A lot. Then one day, she meets this John Holmes motherfucker, and it's like, whoa, baby. I mean, this cat is like Charles Bronson in The Great Escape. He's digging tunnels. All right, now she's getting this serious dick action, and she's feeling something she ain't felt since forever. Pain. Pain.
Chew, Toby, chew.
It hurts. It hurts her. It shouldn't hurt. You know, her pussy should be bubblegum by now. But when this cat fucks her, it hurts. It hurts just like it did the first time. You see, the pain is reminding a fuck machine what it was once like to be a virgin. Hence, Like a Virgin.
It quickly pivots to Mr. White taking Joe's address book away from him after droning on about some girl in it. Then almost immediately, Nice Guy Eddie starts a rousing conversation about K-Billy Super Sounds of the 70s that's currently on the local radio.
When I was coming down here, the night the lights went out in Georgia came on, I ain't heard that song since it was big. But when it was big, I must have heard it a million trillion fucking times. This is the first time I ever realized that the girl singing the song is the one who shot Andy.
Wait, you mean you didn't know that Vicki Lawrence was the one who shot Andy?
I thought it was the cheating wife shot Andy.
Yeah, but they said that at the end of the song.
I know, motherfucker. I just heard it. That's what I'm talking about.
You didn't call me a motherfucker.
I don't.
Before climaxing with the infamous Mr. Pink's I Don't Tip scene, which near the conclusion of the rat in the film gives themselves away if you're keen enough to pick up on it.
Come on, throw in a buck.
I don't tip.
You don't tip?
No, I don't believe in it.
You don't believe in tipping?
You know what these chicks make? They make shit.
Don't give me that. She don't make enough money, she can quit.
I don't even know a fucking Jew would have the ball to say that. Let me just get this straight. You don't ever tip, huh?
I don't tip because society says I have to. All right, I mean, I'll tip if somebody really deserves a tip. If they really put forth the effort, I'll give them something extra. But, I mean, it's tipping automatically. It's for the birds. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, they're just doing their job.
Hey, this girl was nice.
She was okay. I mean, she wasn't anything special.
What's special? Take you in the back and suck your dick?
I'd go over 12% for that.
Hey, look, I ordered coffee, right? Now, we've been here a long fucking time. She's only filled my cup 3 times. I mean, when I order coffee, I want it filled 6 times.
6 times? Well, you know, what if she's too fucking busy?
Words too fucking busy shouldn't be in a waitress's vocabulary.
Excuse me, Mr. Pink, but the last fucking thing you need is another cup of coffee.
Jesus Christ, I mean, these ladies aren't starving to death. They make minimum wage. And I used to work minimum wage, and when I did, I wasn't lucky enough to have a job the society deemed tip-worthy.
You don't care they're counting on your tips to live?
You know what this is? It's the world's smallest violin playing just for the waitresses.
You don't have any idea what you're talking about. These people bust their ass. This is a hard job.
So is working at McDonald's, but you don't feel the need to tip them, do you? Well, why not? They're serving you food. But no, society says, don't tip these guys over here, but tip these guys over here. That's bullshit.
Waitressing is the number one occupation for female non-college graduates in this country. It's the one job basically any woman can get and make a living on. The reason is because of their tips.
Fuck all that.
Jesus Christ.
I mean, I'm very sorry the government taxes their tips. That's fucked up. That ain't my fault. I mean, it would appear that waitresses are one of the many groups the government fucks in the ass on a regular basis. I mean, if you show me a piece of paper that says the government shouldn't do that, I'll sign it. Put it to a vote, I'll vote for it. But what I won't do is play ball. And this non-college bullshit you're giving me, I got 2 words for that. Learn to fucking type. Because if you're expecting me to help out with the rent, you're in for a big fucking surprise.
You just convinced me. Give me my dollar back.
Hey!
Leave the dollars there.
All right, Ramblers, let's get rambling. Wait a minute. Who didn't throw in?
Mr. Pink.
Mr. Pink? Why not?
He don't tip.
He don't tip? What do you mean you don't tip?
He don't believe in it.
Shut up. What do you mean you don't believe in it? Come on, you. Cough up a bucket, cheap bastard. I paid for your goddamn breakfast.
All right, since you pay for the breakfast, I'll put in. But normally, I would never do this.
Never mind what you normally would do. Just cough in your goddamn butt like everybody else.
And that's our list for this week. Did we leave something off? If so, then please feel free to give us your top 5 list in the comments below or on our socials. And be sure to click the subscribe button so you don't miss out on a single list. While you're at it, go and check out our bi-weekly podcast on your favorite podcasting site. Or don't. Fuck it. Do you. Until next time, may Tarantino be with you always.